Hi everyone, welcome to my series Finesse and Flair. Today we are honored to have one of the most popular and well-known generals of the Indian Army amongst us today. A very warm welcome to General G.D. Bakshi. Major General G.D. Bakshi comes from a military family. His elder brother, Captain S.R. Bakshi, was martyred in the 1965 war. He is a combat veteran of many skirmishes on the line of control and counter-terrorist operations in Jammu and Kashmir and Punjab. He commanded his battalion in active operations in Kargil and was awarded the Vishisht Seva Medal. Later, he commanded a brigade in counter-terrorist operations in the very rugged mountains of Kishtwar and was awarded the Sena Medal for his distinguished services. He subsequently commanded the reputed Romeo force during intensive counter-terrorist operations in the Rajouri, Poonch districts of Jammu and Kashmir in the wake of Op Sarp Vinash and succeeded in pacifying the area. He has served two tenures at the prestigious Directorate General of Military Operations. He is a prolific writer on military and non-military matters and has published 37 books and over 300 papers in many prestigious research journals. He has been an instructor at IMA Dehradun and Defence Services Staff College Wellington for 3 years each. He holds a master's degree in defence science and an MPhil in strategic studies from the University of Madras. He has done his PhD in limited wars in South Asia. He taught at the National Defence College at New Delhi before he retired in June 2008. For 5 years, he has been a senior security advisor with RIL and responsible for securing the refineries against terrorist attacks. He is currently the editor of the largest circulation defence magazine, Indian Military Review. He regularly conducts corporate lectures on leadership and motivation and runs case studies on operations in Kargil. He is a very popular TV commentator on Prime Time TV and known for his clarity and forthrightness of his views. In 2018, he was honored by the Chandrasekhar Azad Rashtriya Samman Award.
Thank you so much, first of all, General Bakshi. Thank you ever so much. I'm really, really obliged and honored to you that you've come on my show and really, really happy and, elated that you've come on my show. It means a lot to me.
Thank you, mere bacche. We are all part of the same Fauji family. So you are as much a part of the house and family as my daughter and granddaughter.
Thank you. Thank you ever so much.
Thank me. It's all in the family.
Thank you. Thank you so much, General Bakshi. So, General Bakshi, I wanted to actually have this conversation with you because I'm sure you're not aware because you're a very busy man. I know you have too much happening in your life. But I have been interviewing a lot of, veterans, ex-veterans, serving veterans from the army who have left a mark in the army with the kind of work they have done. And we all know the kind of work you have done. So I was very keen for you to come on to this show and just share with everybody, your experiences based on the questions, very few questions that I wanted to ask you because you've had such a glorifying, such an interesting journey while you were in the army. So just wanted you to, share some of the things that you experienced while you were in the army. Like I know that during your command assignments, you were in the counter-terrorist operations where, most of your command assignments were in very volatile areas. So how was that experience? How was that for you? It must have been very, it must have been a lot of pressure, of course, but you handled it so well. So just want you to just share with us that how were the experiences or anything that stands out in your mind?
You know, my course is the batch of 1971. And right. we call ourselves the Born to Battle batch.
Okay. Right?
My batch was to be commissioned in December, 14th December 1971. Somewhere in October, you know, the clouds of war were gathering. And the adjutant called us all in the drill square and he said, guys, I've got good news for you. You're going to be commissioned a month in advance. So we all started cheering and we were quite thrilled. So he said, pipe down, you guys. Then he told his assistant adjutant, poor chaps, they don't know what they're in for. You know, and you were damn right. Because a month later, in 14th November 1971, we got our commission. We were given 10 days to see mama, papa. Most of us were 19, 20, 21, you know. And after spending that 10 days of casual leave with mom and dad, we got onto the trains and we got straight at Siliguri. And let me tell you, Siliguri was swarming with troops. You know, there were troop train, tanks, this, that, and the rest. And there were soldiers with helmets with their bayonets gleaming in the sun. So they came to receive us, our boys. And we got down, we started hugging one another. We never knew when we would see one another again. Right. So a whole lot of us were in that same train. And the boys said, Saab, jaldi karo, Palton Bangladesh mein hai. You know? Oh. So we said, yaar, ye trunk shank kahan dalna? He said, you don't worry about the trunk, Saab. Ye pakado apni helmet. Or ye pakado apna machine carbine, please fix the bayonet because action could start anytime, you know. And hurry up, sir, and all that, you know. So that's how we, you know, we got into the trucks and we went to our units. Most of us were in action on the very first night of our service.
Wow.
Very first night of our service, we were in action. And it's sad to say that many of us, we didn't know the boys. Boys didn't know us. From Adam, you know, and we were so keen to impress every young second lieutenant is, my God, I'll make a name for myself. This is my great chance. So we went charging and most of us got shot up. You know, some lost their legs, some lost their arms and some died. So that means our mom and dads, they got our pension before we got our first pay. Many of us.
Okay.
Yes, that's right. That's why we are called the Born to Battle batch. And let me tell you that second lieutenant Arun Khetrapal, Param Veer Chakra, is my badge.
He's
my badge, you know. And he was a boy who, you know, he went with his unit into the Battle of Basantar. You know, they had to get into the bridgehead, which was being attacked by 100 Pakistani patterned tanks. And they got in with about 18 tanks, one squadron and a troop. And Lieutenant General Hanut Singh leading the charge as a colonel, half colonel then. And he went to the most threatened flank where the main attack came. So he shot 3 Pakistani tanks, you know. The other 2 tanks of his troops were destroyed. So then when he shot the 3rd Pakistani tank, his tank caught fire. And he was ordered to abandon tank. Because, you know, inside the tank there are 40 rounds of high explosive anti-tank and all that. That goes up, you will be toast.
Right.
Less than toast, you know. Toast is in fact. So he was told to abandon tank. He was bleeding. You know, the blood was getting into his eyes. So he just, you know, he wiped that blood away. And he said, my gun is still firing. My gun is still firing. I'll get these bastards. And he destroyed 2 more enemy tanks. And then the last tank that was left, Pakistani, that was Major Khwaja, who later became a brigadier in the Pakistan Army. And they both shot at one another because he was bleeding. He missed.
Okay.
The blood was getting into his eyes. He missed. And that's where he died instantly. After destroying 5 Pakistani tanks at the age of 21, he's our youngest Paramveer Chakra. So that's what life was all about. So this was our introduction to military life, quite a hot, bloody reception, you know, and from there we never looked back. Most of my batch, number of us rose to be lieutenant general, 3-star, 2-star general, brigadier. We did very well. In the battle for Bangladesh, we did very well. We may have lost, paid a heavy price, but in 14 days, we had marched 550 kilometers inside Bangladesh, captured the capital city of Dhaka, and 93,000 Pakistani prisoners of war had surrendered. The biggest mass surrender after the Second World War. And we, with the force of arms, we created a new nation state. We broke Pakistan in two and we found Bangladesh. And we were at the cutting edge of that action. The second lieutenants leading the charge. So we are very proud of our badge. And then personally, at a personal level, I never look back. And from one action field to the other, all my command assignments have been in combat. I was twice blessed or thrice blessed, or I would say five times blessed. You know, and in 1985, I was in the Punjab. You know, and you know, 84, what happened? The worst period of our life.
I was in Punjab at that time. I was going through
worst period, nightmare that we had to live through. The Golden Temple action had taken place in 84. And so help us God, I was in 4th Battalion Jammu and Kashmir Rifle, commanding a company of Khalsa boys, six-footers from the Manja belt, which is a criminal belt. Right. Guys wouldn't think of chopping a guy's head off, you know, without, and they were angry and they were hurt.
Yes,
and
of course.
Fully understand why they were angry and they were hurt. So I had been commanding Dogra companies all my life because I was in another unit. I had come from Six Jack. So the CO told me, you will take over the Khalsa company. So I quailed actually because of the circumstances. So I said, sir, let me command the Dogra company. I'm used to the Dogras. So I had just come back as a BM. I was the brigade major and all that of a brigade. So he said, well, you are going to go far. You are a staff college. You are a BM type. I want you to feel the experience of command of all types of troops. Don't bloody act like a ninny. Go and take the charge of that company. We were in border sealing operation. We were all alone. Right. And for quite some time, I had to sleep with the Sten under my pillow. Because I wasn't sure what would happen. And if my boys, you know, got beyond, pushed beyond the edge, they were capable of getting up and pumping bullets into me. Mm. But let me tell you, Pia, I never got more loyalty from any set of guys than from those boys. I had to leave them in operation against their own people, their own villages. But I explained to them what was at stake. Mm-hmm. I told them, look, the people who are pretending to be our friends across the border are the same people. If you read the Guru Granth Sahib, Tatiya Dega Ich Jalaye Gaye, Aare Naal Chiraye Gaye, Jinda Chinaye Gaye. Who did that? Their ancestors. And today they came to be the guys most well-disposed towards us. They just want you in trouble.
Yeah, true.
To punish you for what you did to sort them out.
Yeah.
And don't. Another Ranjit Singh conquered the whole Punjab, destroyed the bloody Mughal Empire, went up to Afghanistan, Jalalabad, from where all the rapists, murderers and attackers and looters had come.
Yes, and absolutely.
Allah was in command at Jalalabad. So they don't like the Sikhs. Let me tell you this. They hate the Sikhs. They want, what one better way of getting them punished from their own people, from their own this thing, than to create this kind of a problem. And we are having it again.
Yeah.
The second. So, but so therefore I spoke to them frankly, straight out, put it on the table. My company officer, that poor second lieutenant, he almost fainted when he heard me talking to those boys in that blunt, straightforward way. But it worked.
It worked.
I have never had more loyalty than from that set of boys.
Well,
you know, amazing the way they perform. And you know, the Khalsa troops are no great respecters of rank and position and all. Either they like you or they don't like you.
Don't like you, true.
You could be their boss, you could be their major, colonel, this thing, that thing. I could give a fig to you. And people who are so blunt and straightforward. They don't mince any words. And you know, Punjabi can be very descriptive and with the
they
good
can, epithet. Be very unkind with their words if they want to be.
Very, very straightforward. Very straightforward.
Yes, yes.
Straight people. That's the other part, you know.
Right.
And I have great history. My family roots go back to Banda Bairagi, Baba Paraga, Bhai Mati Das. You understand?
Is that
my ancestors who was brought up into my direct ancestors, Bhai Mati Das, right? So I had a strong connect, and possibly because of that connect, I did. My best performance was with those Khalsa boys.
Amazing. Wow.
So in combat. So then I had to go back to my own unit. I had been sent there for a small time. And what a send-off these boys gave me, you know. So, you know, the Khalsas are very individualistic, you know. The tall guys. I had the best athletes, best wrestlers, best this. And in the inter-company competition, because of our infighting, you know, letting down jealousies, etc., we were not doing so well. We were coming third, fourth, last out of five companies. So I was very unhappy. So when I was great, when I got posted to the military operations directorate after 2 years of my stay with this Khalsa company, we were on border sealing operations in Punjab, and they rigged up a darbar Sainik Sammelan for me. There were no flowers, so they got those paper, you know, buntings to put around my
neck. Okay. We
the Ferozpur area, desertic kind of an area. So then I told them, look, I'm now going. I spent 2 years with you guys, and thank you for all that you did, etc., etc., etc. And I, in my whole 2 years, I never asked for a penny. I never took a pin home from the office. But wow. Now that I'm going, I will demand of you a gift. They were shocked. They looked at one another and they looked at me. What's this guy? Is he now in his true color? He says, I demand of you a gift. But don't say yes unless you have the dumb to give it. Okay? So will you give me a gift at my going? So then the Khalsa pride, the Jat pride was, you know, aroused.
And of course.
You know, to bowl. That is the Jat pride. What do you think? We can't give you, we are small guys or what? He said, to bowl asidyan. I said, good. That's what I expected. I said, now the gift that I demand of you is that when I joined this company, you blighters were last in the intercompany competition. Right? And when I'm going, the gift that I want is that when the raising day of the unit comes about 3 months down the line, I want to hear from you wherever I am. You will call me and tell me that you have won that bloody company competition. Can you give me that gift? You have the guts. You'll get over your squabbling and your, you know, Patiala da, Maja da, Naba da, you know.
Right.
So, well, there were the hugs, this thing, jaykaras and all that. And then I left the unit. You know, you cry when you leave your boys. So I went off to the military operations directorate in Delhi. That's where the entire planning is done. The Sri Lanka operations were on. We used to go at 6 in the morning with our packed breakfast and packed lunch, come back at night, 12:30, 1, 2, 3, and be back there. No Saturday, no Sunday. That is what the military operations director
did. They give you your gift, General Bakshi? I want to know. Did your soldiers
That's precisely what I'm coming to. You know? Okay. And then what happened was, I forgot all about this conversation because I was so damn busy, I didn't have time to breathe.
Right.
One day, I was, you know, the chief was to come to the operations room, the vice chief was to come, and I had to do that briefing, and I was running about like a blue bottom fly and harassed and this and that. And suddenly, when all that finished and I was going up, we used to be in the mezzanine floor. So my G1 ops, Kalnan from the Gurkhal, he said, GD, there were some guys calling you persistently. There were some phone calls for you from Amritsar and all that. I said, huh? Phone calls? Who? I said, who? I'm dealing with Sri Lanka, so I should get calls from that side, not from so-and-so division, all that. Yeah, I don't know. They sounded like some Johnnies. So I went up and I asked the exchange who's called the book. In the meantime, the call came again. And on the line was Darshan Singh, my company Havaldar Major. And you know what he said? Saab ji, asi jit gaye. Asi kya si na? Oh, aap ji nahi kehte. Tenu. ਤੈਨੂੰ ਕਿਹਾ ਸੀ ਨਾ ਅਸੀਂ ਜਿੱਤ ਗਏ ਯੂ ਨੋ ਆਈ ਹੈਡ ਗੂਸ ਬੰਪਸ
ਵਾਓ ਦੇ ਪ੍ਰੂਵਡ ਇਟ ਟੂ ਯੂ
ਬਟ 4-5 ਮੰਥਸ ਆਈ ਥਿੰਕ ਇਟ ਵਾਸ 5 ਮੰਥਸ ਡਾਊਨ ਦ ਲਾਈਨ ਦੇ ਰੈਂਗ ਅਪ ਟੂ ਟੈਲ ਮੀ ਦੈਟ ਦੇ ਹੈਡ ਫੁਲਫਿਲਡ ਦੇਅਰ ਪ੍ਰੋਮਿਸ ਓਕੇ ਆਈ ਵਾਸ ਨੋ ਲੋਂਗਰ ਦੇਅਰ ਕੰਪਨੀ ਕਮਾਂਡਰ ਦੇ ਡਿਡਨਟ ਹੈਵ ਟਾਈਮ ਟੂ ਟੇਕ ਫਰਮ ਮੀ ਆਈ ਹੈਡ ਰਿਟਨ ਆਲ ਦੇਅਰ ਰਿਪੋਰਟਸ ਵਾਈਲ ਗੋਇੰਗ ਸੋ ਇਟ ਵਾਸ ਨੋਟ They owed their report to me, so he was and you know, tell me though, you know, now you can polish up my. I mean, they don't give a damn for that. Those boys know them well.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
Really win their hearts, and if you won that, they'll follow you to hell and back. They'll lead you to hell and back, and you know that's the kind of josh these guys have. You know,
Amazing.
So. I'm just telling you, this is just a small experience of the boys that you command. The best thing of the Indian Army is these boys.
These boys, absolutely, yeah.
You know, 90% of them come from the villages, Pinda De Munde. And thank God for that. They don't get blisters when they have to dig their trenches. You know, a boy from the town, Shara Da Munda, he'll get Chandiya.
Absolutely, yeah. Yes.
You know, the palms of your hand, they get calloused, you know, with digging.
Yeah.
They can sleep on the ground.
Strong men.
They are so close to the earth, the blessed earth. They are the salt of this earth, our boys. Whether it is the Khalsas, the Jats, the Yahids, the, you know, Rajputs, Kumaunis, Gurkhas,
the Chitras
that I commanded all my life, more or less. So that's the kind, that's the best part about this army. So my next tenure was when I finished the MO directorate tenure, I had to go to Jammu and Kashmir. And my unit was then posted in Kargil at one of the hottest areas.
Right.
You know, the first intrusions in Kargil, when did they happen? Most of us think it is 1999.
Yes.
Wrong. The first intrusions first happened in 87 and they were blanked out of the media. Because they had happened in the worst possible area an intrusion could happen.
Oh, yeah, because one has never heard of that.
You haven't. Most military guys haven't heard of it. But the serving officers have not heard of it. But that was the Kaksar area. Yeah?
Okay.
And it was the area precisely where the intrusion happened is called Dalunang. And there was an operation Dalunang on. You know, and that was just 5 kilometers. The road there is 5 kilometers from the line of control. So that whole story I'll tell you some other time. You know, so at that place, you know, there used to be the Shingo River takes a turn, you know, and joins the Dras River. Yeah.
Okay.
So in the 65 war along the Shingo River, they had laid a minefield. Right. So it's a narrow gorge, deep gorge. When you sit on top, you can't look down. It's so steep, you know. So what happened was that they had laid mines in that gorge. So when handing taking over took place between units after 65, they said, don't go there. There is a bloody minefield. Right? Now the minefield is laid on a slope, 70 degrees, 80 degrees. So what happens when the snow falls, 40 feet of snow falls there. So when the snow falls, all the mines got drifted, went into the Shingo and, you know, they went away. So they were, in effect, that area had no mines. But several units passed and, you know, they were, nobody went there. Because nobody wants to go and die in a damn minefield, right?
Yeah.
So nobody went there and the Pakistanis quietly came and occupied that post. So, 5 kilometer as the crow flies from a National Highway 1 Alpha. Can you imagine the tamasha that happened?
My God, crazy, absolutely crazy.
There, Sipia was in command, very tough guy. So he went up. So he said he found they were, you know, it's a very funny exchange. He went up and said, what the hell are you guys doing here? This is our area. So the Pakistani company commander was a Major Nadeem, a very decent kind of a fellow. He said, no, sir, this is our area. What? Get the hell out of here. He said, no, sir, I'm telling you, this is my second tenure here. I was serving here. From here, I went, did my staff college, went to Quetta, and I have come back, sir. So how are you saying it's your area? For God's sake, there is some misperception. He was so decent, you know. But then, you know, were told to throw them out. The firing started. This thing, they had already gained all the high ground. They were sitting on the heights and we were on the lower ground. And we got hell. You know, in the mountains, 9/10 of the battle is won if you are sitting on top.
Right.
They gave us hell. That poor unit lost about 45 dead. Hundreds of casualties. They had to be pulled out within 3 months. They did a good job. They stabilized somewhat. Another unit was sent. And they tried to improve the situation a bit. Then my unit was sent. You know, and I was told, buddy, you better sort this area out, otherwise we'll sort you out. You know, and you have to spend a full 2 years here. I said, sir, the first unit you pulled out in 3 months because of the pressure. The next one did about 18. And now you are asking me to do a full tenure here of 2-3 years.
Yes.
But so when I reached the unit, I found they were, you know, because we were at the lower ground, we were at the receiving end. The orders from the was don't escalate here. Because you guys will get it. You guys will get it. So grin and bear it. Keep quiet. Don't provoke. So the day that my unit took charge, they could see from the top some khalbal, change of troops taking place and all that. So, you know, one of the Pakistani sentries yelled from there, oh, Grahi. They knew it was we at Dogras had come. They said, oh, Grahi. Sadde naal panga na lehi. ठीक है तुहाडा हुक्म दिल्लियों आंदा है साडा साडी जेब विच है पंजाबी 29 बलूच बदमाश पलटन फ्रॉम पाकिस्तान वन ऑफ द वर्स्ट दे हैव बीन नोन टू मेनी एट्रोसिटीज टॉर्चरिंग प्रिजनर्स टू डेथ एंड ऑल दैट काइंड ऑफ स्टफ सो दे सेड दैट सो माय बॉयज टोल्ड मी दे वर वेरी अनहैप्पी एंड द ऑर्डर्स वर नो ग्रेडेड बेयर So I had to go for the senior command course. So I was sent off. So that is compulsory. So I was sent off. So 2-3 months I wasn't there. And, you know, my predecessor, he came under pressure from the higher authorities. When we were fired upon, he had orders not to fire back. You know, and therefore the boys were very unhappy. So when I came back to the unit, they all complained to me, Sir, kithe le aaye ho sanu? ਉਹ ਮਾਰ ਰਹੇ ਸਾਨੂੰ ਮਾਰਨ ਦਾ ਵੀ ਹੁਕਮ ਨਹੀਂ ਇਹ ਕੀ ਹੋਇਆ ਆਈ ਮੀਨ ਯੂ ਫ੍ਰੀ ਹੈਲ ਆਰ ਯੂ ਟ੍ਰੀਟਿੰਗ ਅਸ ਲਾਈਕ ਬੱਚੀ ਮੈਂ ਆਈ ਵਾਸ ਵੈਰੀ ਵੈਂਟ ਅਰਾਊਂਡ ਆਲ ਮਾਈ ਯੂਨਿਟ ਇਹ ਵੋ ਹੋਏ ਐਂਡ ਦੈਨ ਆਈ ਡਿਸਾਈਡਡ ਦਿਸ ਵੋਂਟ ਵਰਕ ਸੋ ਵੈਨ ਮਾਈ ਬ੍ਰਿਗੇਡ ਕਮਾਂਡਰ ਕੇਮ ਦੇਰ ਆਈ ਟੋਲਡ ਹਿਮ ਸਰ ਦੇਰ ਆਰ ਨਾਟ ਓਨਲੀ ਮਾਈ ਬੋਇਜ਼ ਦੇ ਆਰ ਆਲਸੋ ਯੋਰ ਬੋਇਜ਼ ਇਸੇ ਤੂੰ ਬਹੁਤ ਬਾਤ ਕਰਤਾ ਹੈ ਆਈ ਵਾਸ ਅ ਹਾਫ ਕਰਨਲ ਆਈ ਹੈਡਨਟ ਈਵਨ ਬਿਕਮ ਅ ਫੁੱਲ ਕਰਨਲ ਯੂ ਨੋ ਇਹ ਬਹੁਤ ਬਾਤ ਕਰਤਾ ਹੈ ਇਹ ਵੋ ਡਾਇਰੈਕਟੋਰੇਟ ਸੇ ਆਇਆ ਹੈ ਇਸ ਲਈ ये स्टाफ स्टाफ कॉलेज नहीं है ये इट्स नॉट स्टाफ इट इज एक्चुअल ऑन द ग्राउंड आई सेड सर दैट्स व्हाट आई हैव डन ऑल माय लाइफ बट आई एम टेलिंग यू यू प्लीज अनफ्री आवर हैंड्स डोंट लेट अस फाइट विद वन हैंड टाइड बिहाइंड आवर बैक दिस इज व्हाट यू वांट टू डू आई वांट टू हिट बैक दिस इज आर यू रेडी फॉर द कॉन्सिक्वेंसेस आई सेड यस सर आई हैव गॉट अ प्लान ही सेड अच्छा ठीक है यू हैव द गट्स टू से दिस टू द न्यू जनरल ऑफिसर कमांडिंग देयर इज अ न्यू जीओसी कमिंग You have the guts? I said, sir, he's my boy. If I can't speak up for my boy, I deserve to go home.
Right, absolutely, yeah.
You know, so the new GOC came and fortunately he happened to be a die-hard infantry guy from the Rajputana Rifle, General O.P. Kaushik, quite a living legend. Great, very aggressive, very this thing, that thing. So he came with his staff officer for a briefing by the CO, that's me, yours truly at Kaksar, you know, Dalman, you know. So I briefed him at my battalion command post. And then at the end, I said, sir, I have a request to make. These are not only my boys, sir, they are also your boys. So don't get them bashed. Don't tie their hand and feet down. I just want to know from you, sir, what are my orders? I am responsible for this intrusion. This happened 3 units before me. So what are my orders? Am I supposed to throw them out? There are 3 companies sitting in that area of intrusion. To throw out 3 companies, you need 3 battalions. And because it is the mountains, you will need about 6 battalions.
Right.
So are you going to sanction? I can't do it as one single battalion where it takes 6. So what are my orders? Am I supposed to grin and bear it? So the staff officer, the colonel from the artillery who had come with the GOC, he was shocked. He said, look at this cheek of this young lieutenant colonel, half colonel, not even a full colonel. He is trying to turn the whole, orders, SOPs in this division. So since, the GOC had come new, he thought he would put him wise and not let him be carried away by what this young hothead was saying. Right. He said, no, sir, he can't do this. So the general turned to him and he said, you shut up. Did you hear the colonel? Did you hear the commanding officer? He's not asked you what he can't do. He's asked you, what is your task? What is the task for him? Have you got a task? Sir, actually, he said, I want a yes or no answer. Have you got a task? Yes, sir. No, sir. Actually, he said, shut up. No, bloody, actually, you shut up. Then he turned to his son. He said, okay, son, you are the CEO here. You tell me what you can do. I was anticipating this. I had a plan and I told him exactly that. And then we carried out that. We built up that area. I found I had all sangars. Sangars means you put pile stones one on the other. So they can stop bullets. But if the artillery shelling starts, they become a death trap. Coincidentally, when I was coming up with my battalion convoy to occupy this area, one of the two Sikh convoys was coming down. And it was commanded by a course mate of mine, Gupta. So he just stopped me. GD, kithe ja rahe hai? Main ja rahe hai, Kargil. Kehta, dekh, I'm coming from the LC. My one piece of advice, dig down, boy, dig down. People will tell you, rock, stone, these things are, kanu dig kara rahe ho, eh, oh. Dig down, otherwise you will suffer. My unit has suffered heavily due to artillery shelling. There was also aggressive boys. They gave it back and the Pakistanis opened up with artillery. And because they were in Sangar, they suffered. He said, dig down, dig down, dig down. Look at God's coincidence. So it was a lesson buried deep in my head. So I said, sir, I'd like to dig down. I'd like to prepare. And then I'd like to kick their butt. So we had a plan and he said, okay. He said, sanction. You do it accordingly. So for a few months, I kept quiet. I ordered them all. They will dig down. And sure enough, the kurkur started, and nobody will tell you to your face that, sir, kyu kara rahe ho and all that, But you understand, there are the mountains, rock, solid rock. Dig down means you use those crowbars, sambals. You use explosives, take a crack, put that crowbar, open it, then dig down further. It is digging rocks, So naturally, my boy said, sir, two units have already been in this area. They never felt the need to dig down. Why are you making us dig down? So, there is a system mechanism in the units. You have the subedar major. So the boys don't talk to you direct. They talk to the subedar major. So my subedar major, Tirath Singh, came to my office and he coughed discreetly. So I knew that he had something private to tell me. So I told the runner, Kumbar Jao. So he said, sir, budde kandin. I said, acha, bol, ki kandin. He said, budde kandin, tin unit gichhe chale gaye. Una ne digni kita, sanu kyun dig kara rahe ho? I said, acha. I said, okay. So is that what they're saying? Is it good? I said, please make out a program. You and I will now go to each company, starting from the left to the right. And that means in those mountains, climbing from 17 to 15,000 feet, on going on. So he thought I was trying to punish him or finger him or, for giving the bad news or good news or whatever. So he made a very sad face. I said, no, it's not that. It is the thank you for telling me this. It is essential that I clarify the point. So I went to each company post, each platoon post of mine. That was when you have to sweat like hell, I assembled the boys at each post on the reverse side, hidden areas. And then I said, look, boys, 3 months from today, mortars and artillery shelling is going to start here. Mm-hmm. Okay. Where would you then like to be? Above ground or underground? They looked at one other, mortar and artillery shelling. So only till then, only small arms fire, rifles, light machine guns, heavy machine guns, medium machine gun. That is the fire that was being done.
Right.
Artillery mortars is a cut above. So they looked at one another as RT mortars, so then we would like to be underground. I said, here are the explosives, here are the crowbars, get digging, jokers. It's my job to see that you go back home alive. It's my job to see that you go back alive.
Right.
And so that's what happened. They all dug down. The Pakistanis were quite surprised. We stopped firing. But they could hear blasting, shasting. They tried to, oh, grind, ki ho gaya. Firing, sharing, band kar ditti. Aage maje. You know, that, it's best expressed in the Punjabi. You know, so they were quite surprised. But we prepared. Then at one post, they had been troubling us unduly. That was a BSF post, where they saw the khaki wardi. And therefore, targeted it very hard. And those poor chaps, I mean, they're not trained for war like the army is. I mean, they were in a bad shape. And that post had had the worst of it all. So when I had taken over, I had gone to that post. And the assistant commandant there was a man about to retire in a few months. He was very sick. Though he was a good Rajput boy, but he was very sick. He was very old, you know. He says, Saab ji, meri tabiyat theek nahi hai. You don't mind if this inspector Saab takes you around the post. I said, okay, you are not well. And since you are going on retirement, I don't want to needlessly there. You relax. So I went down with that inspector. So as I was going down that post, I suddenly found every single bunker bashed up, broken, destroyed. I said, what the hell is this? So then he stopped. He said, sir, iske aage jana bahut khatarnaak hai. I said, what do you mean khatarnaak hai? I have come to see my post. Damn it, this is my post. What do you mean khatarnaak hai? He said, bahut fire. I said, acha? So since he was from the BSF, I said, tu aisa karo saab, ab mere piche ho jao. Just tell me which way to go. Huh? Khatarnaak hai? I mean, he got my gorge, you know. So I said, any other post here? He said, haan saab, ek AD, air defense walon ka post hai. They've got an air defense gun there. I said, take me to that damn post. Just keep guiding me. I'm leading, you follow. So if there's any shot, I'll take it first, okay? Don't give me that crap next time that it is too dangerous. If that boy can stay there, so bloody well can his CO go there, okay? So I reached that post, you know, last position. And it was a ZU-23 air defense gun, Russian twin barrel. You know, it had been placed there and all that, and it used to take part in the firefights. So there was a short little Garhwali boy, Havaldar Rajesh Singh, long Havaldar Rajesh Singh.
I'm amazed you still remember all the names so vividly. Amazing.
You know, so small little boy, 5 feet, nothing, you know. And he came down, saluted me. He said, Saab, aap naye CO saab hain? He said, yes. Saab, mere ko aap se baat karni. Yeah, that's what I've come for. Son, go ahead. Tell me. He said, Saab, zara saab ko bolo, alag ho jaye. So I looked at that BSF guy. I said, Saab, if you don't mind, go to them. Haan, yes, beta, kya hua? He said, Saab, main aapko batana chahta hoon ki hamari Indian Army ki yahan bahut besti hui. Bahut besti hua. I said, how? He said, sir, 3 months, well before you came, you know, the Pakistanis used their helicopters and they brought in an L-60 air defense gun, which outranges my gun by almost 500-600 meters. They placed it there, sir. It is a heavier gun than mine. And they blasted this post. Because I had been giving them a lot of trouble. So they found the answer. They got a gun with a longer range. Kept it out of range of my fire. And they blasted this post. We had told these people not to put the kerosene oil barrels on the skyline. You understand skyline, huh? But, you know, since it's tougher to carry it down and easier to put a pipe and take it from there, you know, they kept it on the sky. So they hit those K-oil barrels and they caught fire and the whole post, 100 feet high plane, and they use anti-tank guns. They blasted every bunker in this post. And the poor BSF boys were driven to the back of that post on the reverse slope, and that's where, from where they haven't come forward. But he said, that is not bad enough, sir. I said, oh, you got something worse to tell me? He said, yes, sir. He said, all these BSF boys, they went to the back of the post. Since then, they haven't come forward. And if I had not stuck onto this post at the end of this outpost, we would have lost it to the Pakistanis. But sir, that was not the worst part. The worst part is that after they had fired and silenced this whole post, the Baluchis came on top of their bunkers and they did bhangra.
Oh gosh.
Understand? Ki maa ka doodh piya to ab fire karo. We are dancing in the open air we are. You know, it got my gorge. I said, okay, kid, you said what you had to say. Leave the rest to me. Said, thank you, sir. Please don't mind, but I had to tell you.
Right.
Said, okay. So I went back to my headquarters and I rang up my brigade commander and I said, sir, we are both lucky that we are still holding our ranks. You know, you don't tell that to your brigade commander. You know, you are very angry. You're the jart. What do you mean? I said, sir, I have just been to that damn post and this is that post is khali. Had the Pakistanis taken it, sir, we would have gone home in shame and ignominy. Oh my God. Is that so? I said, yes, sir. That is the fact. He said, sir, I want permission. Please take the BSF out of here. I'll handle this post and I'll kick their, you know what.
Right.
He said, okay, don't get worked up. He says, because it's a different organization. We can't, let them down or we can't tell them that you're not good enough. So whatever it is, don't remove the whole company. Reinforce that post with your own boys and then take them on. I said, okay, sir. So we did that. I called Sher Singh, was my subedar, and he was sweating to become the subedar major. So I said, Sher Singh, yes, sir. Then you want to become the subedar major of this unit? He said, yes, sir. I said, go to that damn post. I want you to turn it around. I want you to get it in fighting shape, all right? And when you are ready to fight, let me know. I'll come there. I want to see that fight. Okay? So, yes, sir. And he went and he was a very tough, dynamic guy. They rebuilt that whole post. They repaired every bunker that had fallen. They stacked it with ammunition. I said, that's not good enough. Then I sent two anti-tank guns up there. You know? And then I asked my brigade commander, I said, I want an artillery piece for direct shooting role. So he sanctioned me a 75/24 howitzer. This is a mountain gun which fires up to 11 kilometers. This post Pakistani was 1100 meters. So you can imagine the impact of a shell that is supposed to go 7 kilometers. What impact would have 7 meters. So we wanted to take it up. So we asked the mules to carry that bloody gun up. You know, the climb was so steep, Bia, that two of my mules rolled over. You know, it's a very unstable load. And one mule died and, you know, a mule death in the army, a heavy court of inquiry, this, that, who ordered that gun, this and all that. You know, so then I said, sir, he said, look, Jiri, I tried to help you, but I'm sorry. We lost the bloody mule. I can't help you beyond that. I said, sir, I'll just don't take that gun back. I'll have it put on top. He said, how the hell will you do it? I said, sir, leave that to me. Leave that to the infantry, Jugaad. So I went to that village of Chilasis, who were the locals of that area, and Baltis. And I said, I'll give you two cases of bloody rum, okay? I want you to take this bloody gun up. We'll break it up into parts, sling it up on bamboo poles, and take this up. He said, two cases of rum. We will take. So, you know, and the whole bloody village, men, women, children, old men, they all got together. We broke that gun into many parts. And can you believe it? They took it up that mountain, almost 14,500 feet high, straight climb like that. And that gun. So when we got that gun, they were ready. They said, sir, we are ready now to fight. Please come up. So I went there with my subedar major. And, you know, I got on top of the highest peak in that post from where I could see everything for miles around. And I said, are you guys ready? He said, yes, sir. I said, fire! Every single gun opened up in that post. You know, including that air defense gun and the two anti-tank guns. And we had that artillery piece. So in the excitement, that was behind me. So in that excitement, we didn't pass the order to them. And it was manned by a battery of Khalsas. So तो खालसा फॉर्म नीचे ते येल डेट भी साहब जी सानू भी मौका मिलना चाहिदा हैपेंस ओनली आर्मी एज आर यू वेटिंग फॉर गिव इट टू देम सो ओवर देयर ओपन साइट्स विद दैट आर्टिलरी गन दीज बॉयज लेट गो 80 rounds they fired. 80 wow. artillery rounds. You can imagine what that means. The Pakistani post was devastated. I have never in my service career seen a thing like that, bete. You know, their stone sangars, they began to flow down like a waterfall of rocks. I have never seen a thing like that. And the Pakistanis cried across in panic, "Grai, pagal ho gaye ho, band kar do, band karo." You know, and we bashed the smoke and fire on that bloody post. And then, you know, suddenly my signal operator was standing next to me. You know, he just tapped me gently on my arm. He said, "Sir, sir." I said, "Haan beta, kya hua? What's it?" I said, "Don't disturb me with any calls from the rear. I'm fighting. You tell them I'm not available." He said, "No, sir, no, sir. The brigade headquarter isn't calling. But just see, sir. Wo dekho. I said, "Kya hua?" So I looked at that side and I saw the Pakistanis had raised a white flag.
Oh.
That means we've added, boss.
Humko chodo.
Please cease fire. We've had it.
Yeah.
You know? So he showed me that white flag. It was fluttering in the breeze above one of the outposts of the Pakistanis, you know. So I looked at that my binocular, and then I put my binocular down and I looked at that boy. He said, "Tere ko dikh raha hai?" I asked him, "Tere ko dikh raha hai?" So now it was in plain sight. So he was flabbergasted, that poor boy. He was a jawan. I was a half colonel, that's quite a difference, you know. So he didn't know what the hell was expected out of him. So he looked at me, you know, flabbergasted, and he said, Haan, sir, dikh raha hai, sir. I said, "Tere ko dikha?" "No, sir." Now he knew that his commanding officer wanted. So he gave him the answer, "No, sir." I said, "Look, these guys have made our lives miserable for so many months. I am not going to let them off because they raise a white flag. I want them punished. I want to, you know, I don't want to use military language. And then I want to ram it up. We will not take it lying down and teach them such a lesson that they dare not touch my boys again. As I'll land them." And every single weapon in that post, the anti-tank guns, the air defense gun, the artillery piece, you know, the rocket launchers, Dar, my God, what an orchestra. What an orchestra.
Wow.
There the sound echoes from the mountains all on all sides. It's quite an experience, you know. And we banged them for an hour and a few minutes. But there was no response. They all of the Pakistanis, they simply left, deserted their posts, and they went to the reverse slope and they hid themselves. So then after some time, my boy said, "Sahab ji, maja nahi aa raha." They are not. I said, "Give it to them for 10 minutes more. 10 minutes more. So they gave it to them for 10 minutes. And then I told my Subedar Major Sahab, "Tera Singh Sahab, sir, the CT bajai hai." So do lambi CT baji, that was ceasefire. I said, "Okay." He said, "Now, sab jawan meri awaaz sun rahe hai?" "Yes, sir." "Apne apne bunker ki chhat pe aao." So all the boys came out of their bunkers and stood on the roofs of their bunker in open enemy sight. I said, "Ab bhagda karo." You understand? "Ab bhagda karo." Now you got the guts. You know? Now try and fire at us. Fire at my boy. Let me see. You got the guts, you so-and-so. Fire at my boys now. Let me see. You know, my boys danced for
half hour. Totally.
My boys danced for half hour. In such Josh, the Bishnoi boys also sent their best platoon to fight there, you know, and to take revenge.
There was an amazing for them.
Whisper from there. Nary a whisper from that Pakistani post. And that post never dared fire at us again.
Wow. What
that is the way you teach a lesson. That is the way you teach a lesson. So I'll stop here because, you know, Yudhasya Katha Ramya. A Sanskrit proverb says the tales of war are enchanting. In the villages, the old white-haired soldiers like me, they sit around little fires and they tell the stories to the grandchildren of the village. And they all gather around. Tell us the stories, Baba. Tell us the stories, Baba. That's how soldiers are made.
Absolutely. But your stories are so
intense. I leave it here because you have to move on. So have I. But
I also, General Bakshi, want to know that, you know, post-retirement, you have been into a lot of motivational talking. You're one of the most popular commentators on prime time TV. And you do so much more. You've done so much. You've been part of RIL as well. You've done so much. So beyond that, you've also had the time to write 37 books and 300 papers. And it doesn't end at that. And you're also into poetry. So I want to know, how do you get the time to do all of this and much more? How many hours in the day do you have and how do you manage to do so much?
You see, if you like doing what you're doing, then you never feel tired.
I totally agree with you. That's my motto in life as well.
You will self-actualize. If you like communicating and you are communicating, you wouldn't mind doing it 24 hours a day. If you like painting and somebody gives you the paint and the material and the canvases, you'll paint your life. You'll sculpt, you'll paint, you'll write poetry because you are doing what you like doing.
Right.
You understand? The secret in life is to find out your inner nature, your swadharma, and choose that as your job, your profession. You'll be the happiest man. You'll pay them to let you do that work.
Absolutely.
I never asked for pay raise, this raise, that raise. I never looked at my pay slip. I was very poor at maths. That's why I joined the infantry. I never could make the hell out of what the hell is my payslip. They are bank mein kitna gaya hai, bata de. So I can tell mama that you can only spend so much and not more, you know. And the rest is okay. You're more interested in doing your job. Far more interested. If you love your job, and I love my job in the military, I love communicating with the kids. So my payback time after retirement was I've been to schools and colleges talking to the kids about the army, the system of values in the army, about country, about courage, about nationalism.
Amazing.
That's what it's all about. So I've been, and nobody pays me to do it. I do it because I love it. I love interacting with the kids. And then, of course, the TV channels pick me up and they go, and I like communicating and what. Possibly a lot of channels invite me because I speak no holds barred.
Yeah, you're very candid, very forthright.
If they like it, it's good. If they don't like it, I couldn't give a damn. I couldn't give a damn.
That's why they love you, because you're so candid.
Anywhere. I don't have to become an ambassador anywhere. I was a 2-star general and I thought that was a damn good thing to be. And I'm very satisfied. I'm very fulfilled. I'm very happy. I loved every minute of it. If I have my life all over again, I'd still join the army. You know, I still look back at my NDA days with great pride, with great nostalgia, my unit days. And the boys, they were the best part of it all. And I now try and enthuse youngsters to join the armed forces. Because we are getting a soft nation. I'm sorry, we are becoming too Gandhian for comfort.
Yes, true. True, very true, absolutely. So, General Bakshi, before we close, I'd like to know a little about your family as well, your wife, your children, your family, because everybody knows you to be this very strong, very candid general who's on TV and who, you know, speaks his mind all the time, but nobody really knows about your family. So, I want to know a little bit about your family, your wife, your children, your parents, all of that, the personal side to your life.
Thank you. There, you know, I got married to Sunita in 1978. I was then serving as an instructor in the IMA. And, you know, she is deeply into Sikh history, which okay. I am also wow. equally very fond of. And she is a history, MA in history, BA and all of that. And then, you know, we got our first house, you know, that a captain's accommodation, lieutenant's accommodation, actually. And that was overlooking the Tons. And it had a balcony from where you could see the Tons River and you could see Mussoorie. Like diamonds in the sky at night, hung suspended midway like the Milky Way. My God, what a lovely place to start your career and your married life, Dehradun.
You know, and,
it was beautiful. It was beautiful. And then, of course, we had my son Aditya and then my daughter Purnima. So I have a boy and a girl as per the poster. We've been very beautiful citizens. Aditya joined the Merchant Navy. He became a captain. He sailed the seas of the world. Wow. I wanted him to join the army. He says, no, if I join the army, they'll all tell me that I don't want to be your ADC. They'll tell me I'm doing well because of my dad. So I don't want to go there. I make my own way. So, you know, then he joined the Merchant Navy and he sailed for about 20 years, more or less. Now he's into making documentary films. And he's made a series of documentary films called The Famous Battles of India, which were run on the Epic Channel, also on national channels like Republic, Times Now, and Aaj Tak, that, you know.
Amazing.
He's now into making feature films on the armed forces. We are trying to popularize the ethic of fighting, warrior ethic. Because like I said, we've become too damn Gandhian for our comfort. And if we become so Gandhian with countries like Pakistan and China around, we will cease to exist. So that fighting has to be aroused. So that's what he's doing. He left his very lucrative Merchant Navy career to help me in making these films and war comics on our Paramveer Chakra winners, by the way. He started a series of war comics on them and all that. So that's my son, my daughter, Purnima. She's done her PhD in the history of art. She's a painter. And she's also now making films on ancient history. Just working on a film on the Bhimbetka Caves. She and my son put together Bhimbetka Caves. So you'll see it shortly. So that's my family. And now I have, you know, I never got time to spend with my family because I was mostly in combat areas, field station. And my wife, she had to struggle alone in separated family quarters and she raised them more or less single-handed. And, you know, after retirement, I was once given a Lifetime Achievement Award. So I was quite surprised. And when I went there, I found I was in the company of TSR Subramaniam, Cabinet Secretary, and, you know, our Election Commissioner Qureshi Saab. Well, people, I was feeling quite small. I'm just a two-star general and all that. These are top-notch people. So when my turn came, they invited me on stage. And they asked me, General, you spent 37 years in the army. So I said, 41 if you count my NDA and IMA. So they said, okay, 41 years in the army. And what was your greatest achievement? You tell us. You know, they were asking each guy to come up on stage after he received his prize. So I looked them straight in the face and I said, my greatest achievement was staying alive.
That's so true.
As a combat soldier, I served in 71 war, I served in Punjab, I served in J&K thrice. I served in Kargil, regular war, Kishtwar, counter-terrorist operations. Finally, before my retirement, I was general officer commanding Romeo Force in Rajouri and Poonch, the worst areas of Jammu and Kashmir, and I survived. So I said my greatest achievement has been to stay alive. And for that, I must thank my wife and my daughter, who while I was fighting, they prayed for me. They spent their time praying.
How nice, lovely. No, it's been such a pleasure. It's been such a pleasure, General Bakshi. Thank you so much Like I said, it really means a lot to me that I know you're a very busy person and you've taken out time to come and share your brilliant stories about being in the army, your men, your passion is so clear when you speak about the army, how passionate you have been. And like you said, live your passion. And now you're living your passion through communicating your army stories to, you know, the whole world, to through media. I think you're doing a brilliant job. So thank you so much. And please continue doing the good work that you're doing.
Thank you. Jai Bharat. Jai Hind.
Jai Hind. Absolutely. Thank you so much. Thank you, General Bakshi. Really, like I
thank
said.
Thank you, beta. Pleasure talking to an army kid, to an army daughter. God bless you. Give my regards to dad and to everybody.
I will. Thank you so much.